Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 41 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. This week, I had the delight of bringing you our very first guest from across the pond, Jeremy Corner. Jeremy is a greeting and gift industry influencer with a passion for connecting people using beautiful cards, stationery, and digital tools like social media. Jeremy is the co-owner of Blue Eyed Sun and Ivy Ellen, a speaker, thought leader, and contributor. He is a Sage business expert and Sage blogger. Blue Eyed Sun publishes gorgeous handmade greeting cards. Jeremy and his business partner, Joe, have grown the business from a small bedsit in Brighton into one of the leading British card publishers selling to over 18 countries around the world. The company recently won a Queen's Award for international trade. I met Jeremy at Sage Summit here in Atlanta, Georgia. I attended his session. We became quick friends and I invited him on the show. And I recently had a birthday on June 15th. And we just sort of, you know, exchange information. I gave him my address. And on my birthday, on June 15th, I go to the mailbox and I get this package from Great Britain. I'm like, who is sending me a package from Great Britain? And I should have expected it, but it came as a complete shock and surprise. And I could not have been more delighted. So this man walks his talk. He is the genuine article. So without further ado, let's get into our interview with Jeremy Corner. Jeremy, thanks so much for joining me.
Hi, Tammy. Lovely to be here.
Awesome. So we met at Sage Summit and you were one of the speakers. And, you know, that is a high, high honor to be asked to speak at Sage Summit and be one of the mentors. And you also have carved out a very healthy niche for yourself in the competitive market of greeting cards. You're going up against the big boys like Hallmark, but it wasn't always like that. Nobody starts at the top. Everyone starts somewhere. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug and how did you become enchanted with business and marketing?
Well, I think I've always been interested in business from a young age. My first job was working as a waiter in a restaurant in South Africa where I grew up. And it was the perfect job for me at 16. The guy, I don't think he knew that I was 16. I think he thought I was 18 because I was serving alcohol and looking after a lot of customers. But I had my own kind of set of covers, my own kind of area. And I had a float in a little kind of bum bag on me, and I would collect in all the payments from the customers during the evening, and then cash up at the end, and give him all the money, and anything that was left over, including the float, was mine to keep. We used to get sales commission for upselling onion rings and T-bone steaks, and toffee Don Pedros, which were kind of like a liqueur milkshake, which is very nice. I think that was a real grounding for me. You know, in business, because I could recognize that actually if I did a good job of selling, I liked people, you know, then I could make money doing that. And even though it was on a very kind of small scale with not huge amounts of money, at 16, that was a real eye opener for me. So I think I was always probably on the back of that kind of end up being in some kind of business. So fast forward to years later, my then girlfriend at the time was, she recognized that she was unemployable and knew that she needed to start her own business. So we made a list of all the things that she could do, and greeting cards was on the list. So she did things like dressmaking and fine art and printmaking, interior design, all sorts of things. She was very creative. And she'd had a shop up in York, in Yorkshire, in Northern England, where all the accents for Game of Thrones come from. And she'd it was a bit of a failure of the shop, but in the shop she'd been making her own cards, and so they were quite a success. And so she put cards on the list and she put a collection together, and I helped her to finance her first trade show. At the time, I had no intentions of growing into the greeting card business. I wanted to be the next Steven Spielberg, and was busy making short films and what have you. And she went to the trade show, and to start off with, she got orders. The first year was very tough going, and we almost jacked it in and became web designers. But we didn't, stuck it out. And the next year, we got some sales agents And the business really took off from there and grew very, very quickly. And so, yeah, and I found myself getting more and more involved and really enjoyed it. You know, things progressed from there to the point actually where about 3 or 4 years later, we were so things were going so well that actually we were completely overworked and stressed out with you know, the amount of the workload. Basically, it was taking over our lives, the business. And so at that time, we met a friend of ours to watch a basketball game. Afterwards, we went for a drink, and his dad was there. And I went to the bar to buy the beers, and I came back, and my girlfriend was in tears because my friend's dad had asked her how the business was going. And actually, that was a real turning point for us, because our friend's dad was a business coach, and he took us through an exercise called Looking Back from Perfect, where we managed within 12 months to half our working week and double our income. And so that was what I was at Sage Summit talking about, was the Looking Back from Perfect exercise. They videotaped that, and I think it's going to be online soon. I'm sure when the link comes available, I'll send it over to you, and you can share it with your listeners.
Awesome. I'm sure they will love it, because I personally got a lot out of it. So if you had a time machine, you could go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. Yes, I watch Doctor Who. What are the top three things you would tell your younger self to help prepare for your journey?
Gosh, that's a good question. I think one of the things I'd personally tell my younger self is to relax, don't stress so much about things. You know, these days I look at every day like a bit of an experiment. So I try new things. I don't have high expectations for them. I think that they'll work out, hopefully, and you know, I'd like them to work out. And obviously I have good focus in terms of choosing the right things. But I don't beat myself up if they don't. You know, if I, so for example, I'm doing a YouTube project at the moment where I make a video every week. And I realized actually the only way I could really do that project well was to take the pressure off myself and not to aim for perfect. So aim for good enough and get going and get moving. Because if you do enough of good enough for a while, you'll start to get really good at it and it'll just get better and better. Whereas if you aim for perfect, you just won't ever start. So I'd say, you know, don't put yourself under too much pressure would be the first thing. You know, we all do that. So try and avoid that. What else? I think staying customer focused has been a really valuable thing for us. And talking with our customers a lot. So asking questions about what's working or what's not working, and having a much stronger dialogue. So I'm pretty good at that these days. I see my customers every week or I go into shops every week. So that stood me in really good stead. But I didn't do enough of that earlier on. I was so busy worrying about everything that was in front of me that, you know, actually, if I'd picked up the phone and talked to a retailer and asked more questions earlier, I would have got further, further quicker. And then the third thing I would say, which is really easy for us to get to forget, is to make sure that you have a life outside your business. You know, keep in touch with your friends. If you like to play golf, make sure you play golf or whatever it is that you like to do. So I love to run. I loved to run when I was a boy. And so I reconnected with that after many years of sort of just being really busy. I put on weight early on in the business because, you know, it's just focused on just the business and I didn't have a life outside. So I think it's really important that, because it helps you to keep everything in perspective. You know, sometimes business, we kind of throw ourselves into it, don't we? Especially if we've got kids or we've got family, you know, men in particular, I find they just throw themselves into the work, and in their heads, they justify it. We all do it. We justify it by saying, I'm doing this for my family. I want to make a better life for my family. And actually, if you were to ask the children of those men, you know, what they most want from their dad, it wouldn't be the money and it wouldn't be the better life. It would be their time. So I would say, make sure that you try and keep things in perspective by, you know, by enjoying your outside life, whether that be your family or some kind of physical activity or whatever it is, rather than just making it all about business.
Sage advice, very sage advice, no pun intended. So now I'm going to ask you to hop in the TARDIS and look into the future, because one of the areas of internet marketing that I follow is mobile/connected devices/the Internet of Things, and sort of the standard example that everybody gives is the smart refrigerator that knows when you're out of milk and automatically adds it to your Amazon shopping list, which is then delivered via Amazon drone. And in that example, that's what they call a closed loop system, because you don't actually have to leave the house. Everything is automated, sort of like the Jetsons. And, you know, there are concerns among certain circles, like, okay, once that future arrives, are marketers going to have jobs? And, you know, what does that look like, especially in industries like yours, where you're more handmade cars, personalized, you know, high class gifts. So once we reach that future of the Jetsons, everything is automated to the 10th degree. How do you see marketing evolving?
That's a good question. I it's very interesting watching, companies like Amazon come along and, commoditize so many of the things that we like to buy. There are a lot of things that we like to buy in our everyday weeks that, in a way, probably should be commoditized, because actually we don't need there to be brands for those things. Like, we just need to know that we can trust that what we are buying is what we think it is. So, obvious examples are kind of fruit and vegetables. Although, having said that, these days we are becoming more conscious about even fruit and vegetables, and we want to know that actually when it says organic, that it is organic, not that it was grown organically and then sprayed with pesticides on the way to the store to keep it fresh. My thing is that, I think that actually marketers will still be needed because we're interested in experience. Millennials, they say, are buying less things and are more interested in experiences. So the question then is, if you're selling products, is like how to actually make that the seller that product an experience. So if you're going into a particular retail store, when you go into that store, is that an experience? And you're seeing all kinds of interesting developments in retail at the moment. Retail in general has had a really tough time in recent years, but there are people who are exploring uses of new technology. We're seeing big brands come into major high street stores. Like, so for example, in London, I don't know if you get these kind of candies over in the US, they're called M&Ms. Do you get those over there?
Absolutely. I'm an M&M freak. Peanut M&Ms.
So M&Ms is like, they've got a whole store experience, like in Leicester Square, which is the main, the main kind of square in London. I guess it's a bit like Times Square in New York. And so you can go into this huge M&M store. It's a whole experience. Same with Lego, like across the road, they've got a Lego store. So Lego is more than just the plastic, because you could completely commoditize Lego if you really think about it. But actually what Lego have done is they've transformed themselves into an experience filled of characters and different licenses from other intellectual properties. So I think we'll see a kind of move towards a creative use of these different intellectual properties to market. For products like ours, so with greeting cards, I mean, you could easily look at a greeting card and think, what's the point in that? There are far more efficient ways of communicating. And that would be true to some extent, in the sense that, if I want to chat with you, I mean, actually, they're even saying, like, I was chatting with the guys from the startup van, I don't know if you met them at Sage, and they were saying they hardly even use email anymore, because it's all like instant messages and DMs and all the rest of it. So, communication technology is very fast moving. It's constantly evolving. And yet you and I, and probably most of your listeners, will all know how lovely it is to get a handmade card or any kind of greeting card with a lovely personal message written inside it, coming through the door on our birthdays, or after we've got a new job, or when we've got married, or when we're celebrating an anniversary, or any other kind of event, when someone's kind of taken the trouble to actually go to a store and or buy it online, it doesn't matter, and think of a message and take the time to think in advance and send it over to you. That's, it's really special, and that in itself is an experience. And I for me, that's, I think, one of the reasons why, certainly in the UK, the greeting card market has stayed relatively stable in recent years, when other items like we've seen book sales, plummet dramatically. Although in the UK, at least, they've plateaued now, and they're actually starting a slow uptrend. But, the greeting cards is still in the UK, so it's £1.7 billion industry, which is, I guess, around $2 to $2.5 billion. It's still relevant. It's still such a lovely experience. So this year I started, it's kind of funny because I have a greeting card business, and I realized, like, last year, actually, I don't send as many cards as I'd like to. And so I set myself this goal this year to send more cards and to record myself doing it. So I set up a YouTube channel, and every week this year I've put up a video about me visiting another shop and buying cards for, you know, birthdays or weddings or whatever it is that's coming up, and talking about why I bought them, who I'm sending them to, and just kind of sharing that experience to try and A, learn more about the card market for myself, and B, try and see how it affects me internally. Because, you know, with all this commoditization of stuff, you know, we can be forgiven for thinking that we're just on some kind of treadmill, you know, because we're almost commoditizing work as well, right? So, you know, we're just constantly just going round and round this like little wheel, like guinea pigs or something in a cage. And actually, you know, I was curious to see whether something as simple as actually buying and sending a card to people, to my friends and loved ones and to people I'd met, would change how I feel about them and how I feel about the world. And, you know, it perhaps also maybe change about how they feel about me. So it's been a really interesting experiment, that. And so I just got my custom URL this week. It's youtube.com/ The Greeting Card Project, if your listeners want to check it out.
I love that. And you're right. It is all about experiences. And you're right. Lego, there's a Legoland here in Atlanta, Georgia, where I live. And they have really made a big push about experiences. And me personally, I am a greeting card sucker. I'm a sucker for a good card. So next question. You, Gary V, and Jay Baer, or insert whichever thought leader if you happen to be at a different conference, Brian Solis, David Merriman Scott, whoever, you're all chilling at the bar after the conference, having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the current professional digital marketing industry, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
Ooh, that's a good question. First of all, I'd love to hang out with those guys at a bar. That'd be very interesting. I love the energy of all those guys, and I enjoy watching and listening to them. The big thing for me is about kind of that support. Now, you see the good guys, they all do this. Like Gary V, you know, he talks about like every view matters, you know, and he'll do a whole range of things. And, you know, so they're not just out to sell the whole time. You know, they're not being, gosh. Okay. So I've got a friend of mine called Thomas Power, and he's got this way of thinking about all this type of stuff. He says that we're moving from what he calls institutional thinking, which is closed, selective, and controlling. So in other words, you know, the way boards function. So boards are very closed in terms of who they let in and the information that they let out. They're selective about what they share, and they're very controlling about how they share it. And he's saying we're moving from that online, we're moving at least online towards network thinking, which is what he calls open, random, and supportive. So you're very open in terms of what goes out there. We're very random, because so you help anyone, all comers coming at you. You know, it doesn't matter whether they're big or they're small. This is very true of people like Gary V, and supportive. So, you know, you're going about the world in a kind of loving way. That's not just, you're not just out for yourself. You know, you're kind of supporting other people, other businesses, putting goodwill back out into the world. So as an example, I mean, the Greeting Card Project for me has been a really important test with that, because it's sort of counterintuitive. You know, very often in business, we're like, okay, how's this going to make me more money? Or how's this going to benefit me in X, Y, and Z ways? But actually, I don't buy my own cards in these videos. I don't say anything about my own business. I'm buying other competitors' cards, so other publishers. I'm going into retailers, a variety of different retailers, and I'm talking about these products. So in a way, you could say, what is the point in doing that? It's absolutely crazy. Why would you buy your competitors' products and talk about them openly? But I see, with the bigger picture for us, and this is in answer to your question, is like, what can we do with marketing going forward? Is we need to be more supportive of one another. You know, we are all in this together. We're not out for ourselves. And I think actually that whole mentality of being out for ourselves on a grand political scale globally is causing us fundamental issues. So at the risk of going heavily into politics with that, I think, you know, we have to come back to a kind of form of cooperation and solidarity between one another as human beings, and we have to look out for one another. So for me, the biggest thing in online marketing going forward is to be open, random, and supportive, and to help others, you know, not just ourselves.
A rising tide lifts all ships.
That's it.
Open, exactly. Random, and supportive. Yeah, I dig it. I totally dig it. Last year, myself and my co-author, we wrote a book called Beyond Buzzwords. And by far, the buzzword of 2016 was influencer marketing. Like, it was all over the place. Jay Baer actually launched a podcast, Influence Pros, with Heidi Sullivan and Juliana Vorhaus. And those in the space warned that it was only a matter of time before we got a spectacular train wreck. Not just a regular train wreck, but a spectacular train wreck. And of course, we've had several faux pas this past year. We've had the whole Kendall Jenner Pepsi dust up where they tried to capitalize off of social unrest. But by far, my favorite example is one PewDiePie. So for those who don't know, PewDiePie is like the original rags to riches YouTube success story. He went from just a guy with a YouTube channel. Now he makes approximately $4 million a year. He was the first YouTube channel with a billion, that's a billion with a B, views. And he previously had relationships with Disney and Maker. And the reason I say previously is because PewDiePie fashions himself as an amateur humorist. And he decided to take shots at the website Fiverr and the outrageous things that you can get people to do for as little as $5. The problem is that the way that in which he chose to go about this was by hiring people to do anti-Semitic things. And of course, you know, the backlash was swift and immediate. He was immediately dropped. But this raises a few questions in the influencer marketing space, because Disney actually received a fair amount of backlash from PewDiePie's followers for dropping him. And Chris Brogan made a very good point on the Marketing Companion podcast with Tom Webster and Mark Schaefer that the way in which younger millennials and digital natives use language is fundamentally different from the way that older generations use language, and what offends us does not necessarily offend them. So my question to you is twofold. Like, do you think that this fiasco with PewDiePie and his antics will embolden those looking for their 15 minutes of fame to be ever more outrageous, given the apparently high tolerance for impropriety that younger millennials and Generation Z, I think it's called, yeah, Gen Z has? Or do you think that, you know, this will have a cooling effect and maybe large brands will do a bit more due diligence before they just try to treat influencer marketing like another media buy?
That's a good question. I mean, it's an interesting one, isn't it? Because I read Chris Brogan's book, Trust Agents, years ago when I first started using social media. And, you know, what they say about trust is that it's won in inches and lost in miles. And I always like that. So, you know, if you're building a brand or any kind of presence, whether it's a personal brand or a business brand, you know, it's literally brick by brick you build that trust. And, you know, you do something stupid and or that's perceived as stupid, even it might not be that you intended had any ill intent, but you know, it's just been picked up that way, you know, that wall of trust can just be knocked down like you know, with a wrecking ball in seconds. So it's funny because PewDiePie actually lives in my town of hometown of Brighton on the south coast of England. And in fact, my son and I were walking on the beach this weekend, and he swears that he cycled past us. I didn't see him, but
awesome. That's what's
yeah, small world. The Kendall Jenner thing and the PewDiePie thing are both interesting questions. I mean, well, PewDiePie, first of all, you know, he's a comic, so we have to be mindful that he's always going to be testing and playing with boundaries. All comedy does touch into these areas, and I guess we rely on the comedians to have a sort of a moral through line. Although where that starts and ends is, you know, is up for debate often. You know, if you see someone like Louis C.K., one person could go to one of his conferences and or one of his conferences, one of his performances, and be completely you know, completely upset by and you know, offended by his talks, but actually another person can go and actually find it hilarious and at the same time recognize that generally Louis C.K. seems to be coming from a good place of understanding, although at times if you took him literally you'd you'd say, how does that make sense? Like if you took a transcript of his show and didn't see the intonation that he does those things with, then you know, you could be forgiven for thinking that he was, for example, homophobic or racist or all these kind of other things. But if you know him and you watch him, you couldn't be further from the truth. So I do think brands have to be mindful. I certainly think when I saw the Kendall Jenner clip, you know, really, I mean, really, that was, you know, it's so funny because in large corporations, everything's done by committee. And the trouble with committees is that it's often not anyone with the guts to stand up and say, guys, this is really offensive. I mean, it was. Instantly, as soon as you saw it, was you know, you could see how people would take offense to that. So I do think that within corporations that are working with you know, with influencers and with influencer marketing, that they need to have people on their teams that are willing to stand up and say, you know what, even though we spent all this money on this campaign, this is not hitting the right tone. This is not right. And certainly they should be testing these things before they put them out. You know, so I'm surprised that some of these things are out, and it does get out, and it does make you wonder whether actually they deliberately let them get out, because of course the publicity is so large and it's in all the papers and everything that actually they still get interest. And you know, the biggest example of it all, of course, is your new president. You know, he's you know, he played pantomime all the way through his campaign and garnered, you know, millions and millions of followers. It did very strongly on social media and, you know, made a lot of noise to attract a lot of attention. And even people who didn't want him in power were spreading his message. So I think we are in an interesting time for this grabbing of attention. Although having said that, if you think about it, there's always been people who've been pushing the boat to grab attention. You know, you can go back to, you know, I remember Madonna bringing out various albums, and she brought out her book, I think it was called Sex. And, you know, that was, you know, very much marketing driven, PR driven. So people will always try and push the boat with their videos and with their content. The truth is with this stuff is that I guess it swings back and forth like a pendulum, doesn't it? So we go through periods where we find that unacceptable. And then there's other periods where it comes out and continues until people go, right, that's enough. So, yeah, I think for anyone using an influencer or working with influencers, you know, that they need to be mindful of these things. We have a woman over here called Katie Hopkins who's in the papers all the time, and she is a PR brand expert, you know, and she makes it her job to say offensive things that that get people all riled up and get her column inches in the paper. So, you know, they are tools at people's disposal. Coming back to the trust element, if you are going to use those tools, you need to be prepared for your brand to be dropped and left, right, and center. But actually, if you want to do well over the long term, I'm a firm believer in actually, you know, building that trust brick by brick and sticking to it as a plan. So, I wouldn't do any of those crazy things, but it does depend on your brand as well.
You and me both is definitely not within my wheelhouse, but I definitely agree that is a pendulum of propriety that swings back and forth. So we are going to take a short break. And then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Jeremy. So stick with me. We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave and now she's a multi-millionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it, hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me, and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon. And we're back. So, Jeremy, without getting political, you know, to the best of your ability, but by all means, be candid, because, you know, candor is the whole point of this podcast. What's your take on the whole fake news fallout on Facebook after the results of the 2016 U.S. presidential election? And for those who may not know, in the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news began to outperform real news on Facebook. And by fake news, I mean these stories were wholesale fabricated, had no factual basis in reality whatsoever. It was not a simple matter of spinning the facts one way or another, which all news does. MSNBC leans left, Fox News leans right. There were no underlying facts to be spun, like these were fairy tales made up. And when the news first broke, Mark Zuckerberg sort of played it off and was like, no. It's highly unlikely that Facebook had anything to do with the outcome of the election. But then in his February 2017 open letter, he conceded that fake news has outstripped Facebook's current capacity to govern it. And they are in the process of rolling out AI, which is artificial intelligence, and other third party means to verify the validity of the news on that platform. And this has sparked a very interesting debate in the digital marketing community, because you have some people who are strictly First Amendment over here in the U.S. and are like, no, Facebook is a platform only. They don't have any business trying to be the arbiters of truth. And then you have others who are like, Facebook is a digital property. And as a property owner, you are ultimately responsible for what goes on your property. It's no different than, let's say, you're away on business and some knucklehead teenagers hop your fence so they can go skinny dipping in your pool and one of them drowns. You put up a fence. They were trespassing. It doesn't matter. It happened on your property and you are responsible. So again, more on the marketing side of things, where do you stand on the whole fake news, alternative facts problem and Facebook's response to it?
These are good questions, Temi. These are deep questions. You know, you can start with what is the truth and work back from that. You know, the truth is, not just, obviously, these are extreme cases of truth manipulation, and not even truth manipulation, are they? They're complete fairy tales. You know, you can equally look at newspaper coverage globally, you know, as having a lot of fairy tales in that as well. Sometimes even newspapers are falling for some of these hoax sites and actually publishing the stories as real news. So the journalists at these papers, the papers are earning less and less revenue these days. And, you know, everyone's cut, stretched for time. And so sub-editors, you know, there's hardly any of them left at these papers. So it's really just the journalist who's, you know, doing, you know, God knows how many pieces per day, and they don't necessarily check as thoroughly as they should. What we need them to, and we need the sources all to be you know, referred to as well. I think anyone who says in a video or in a piece of marketing or in a newspaper that studies have shown X, Y, or Z, we need a little footnote there to the study. You know, people, I saw a really interesting video on Prince Ear. I don't know how you would pronounce that, Prince E. He's an American YouTuber. And, you know, someone was actually talking about the studies that he was referring to in the video because he was talking about depression. And actually, there was no, you know, even if you Google to try and find these studies, there's no evidence of these studies. And when you're talking about something like depression, saying, oh, you know, it's easy, all you got to do is this to fix it, and the truth is it's a lot more complicated than that, then that could potentially actually harm lives and could cause people could cause people to kill themselves. So, you know, I think anyone who's kind of got these kind of platforms and these mediums, they do have some kind of responsibility. It's very interesting to hear the property analogy. I hadn't heard that before. I do think that whilst that's going on, everyone should be mindful that there's a lot more to the news than you think. I did a PR course a couple of years back, and we did a really fun exercise where we got all the main newspapers, and we got asked to circle all of the PR stories. In other words, stories that were serving someone's agenda usually to sell products. And in some cases, 80 to 90% of the newspaper was PR stories. Now, before I'd done that course, I wouldn't have known that was the case. I would have assumed that it was actually genuine news that was, you know, that was relevant and interesting for me. So I think we need to be aware that that is going on a lot more than we think. I think we should all be aware of people like Noam Chomsky. I don't know if you're familiar with him. There's a really great documentary on Netflix at the moment with one of his series of interviews. And we need to be aware that there are bigger forces at play with regards to all of this stuff. As the people, we still have power, though. We still have power as consumers to stand up against this kind of stuff. We have power as electorate to stand up to these things. If you don't like the way the government is, then you can stand up and vote. If you don't like the things that the powers that be are doing, you can get together in a million man march and walk against it. You know, when you watch Chomsky's documentary, he points out that actually marches like the million man march, they're the things that made a difference, you know. And so because the powers that be, if there are a million people in the street waving placards who are upset about something, and you're running that government, you have to do something, unless you're in a completely totalitarian state where, you know, there's no democracy whatsoever. Then they just, you know, can just shoot people, I suppose. But, you know, you're not living that, and unfortunately, neither am I. And so we do have some level of say as consumers. I think also with regards to marketing, every one of us has responsibility to actually stop and think for a second before we share something. Is this real? Is this truthful? Does this make sense? You know, is it possible that this is fiction? And am I helping the world by sharing this? You know, regardless of whether I think it's real or not, am I really helping the world with this when I share it on Facebook? Because so often we just click like and we can get enraged, but these things are designed to enrage us. And certainly, you know, without going too deeply into the election, I don't know if you're aware of a company called Cambridge Analytica.
No, I'm not. Mm-mm.
So Cambridge Analytica are a company out of the UK that are kind of, they're sort of like a data science company, if you like, that essentially are able to draw on all our social media data that we leave up there and develop kind of, if you like, psychological and personal profiles. And actually, they can figure out whether you're likely to vote Republican or likely to vote Democrat. Now, it's no surprise, knowing a little bit more about this company, if you look them up, you can find out plenty of articles written about them. They were on the side of the Leave campaign for Brexit, and they were on the side of Trump. Trump hired them. So, you know, what these guys were able to do was they could figure out whether you are likely to sway towards Donald Trump, and then position content in front of you through sponsored content or through other means so that you can be more swayed to his argument. I mean, the great thing about Trump is he's like a scattergun. So he had loads of different things that he said. So it's just a question of putting the right thing in front of that particular personality profile. And then similarly, if they saw that you were likely to sway away from Hillary Clinton, they could put some negative content about her into your feed through various means. And, you know, these things are having a profound effect because You know, it's all so fast and immediate. And when we sit on these platforms, we're very, very prone to being affected emotionally by this stuff. You know, we all see these emotion, this emotional content coming through. And if it hits us, you know, where it makes us angry or puts some kind of pain or sorrow into us, then we will share that stuff. And so what I would say, you know, as a political action that every one of us can take right now, that is when you feel that stuff, especially if you feel it really strongly, that's the time to stop and just think for a second and think, actually, you know, am I being played here? Is this real? Is this something that's going to benefit other people? Or am I just playing, you know, just taking part in this angry, horrible setup here? And so we can fight back with this kind of stuff, you know, and also we can, you know, we can take to the streets and complain about it. We can vote. We can, there's loads of great, over here in the UK, you can set up a petition that you can put to the government. And if you get enough signatures, they'll actually debate it in the House of Lords or the House of Commons. So, you know, I imagine you'd have the equivalent in America, but if there isn't, you can campaign for that. And, you know, we can take action on these things.
We absolutely can. And that is some deep, deep stuff, because you're right. Trump was a scattergun and there was a lot to piggyback off of. And unfortunately, it's like, you know, digital marketing and analytics like that, it's a double-edged sword. You can use it for good or you can use it for evil. Requiem for the American Dream. That is the documentary with Noam Chomsky on Netflix. I have seen it and I too recommend it. I will make sure to link that up in the show notes. So my next question, I'm particularly interested in your answer as a smaller business who competes with larger corporations like Hallmark, because for a very long time, large corporations were not serious about digital marketing. It's only in the last couple years that they really began to put some weight behind it. I mean, as recently as 2-3 years ago, you didn't even have a position at larger corporations like Coca-Cola, and now they have an entire department. And the flip side to this coin is that they are disproportionately pouring their ad spend into Facebook and Google. Like, it's not even close. Just between those two properties alone, they're gobbling up like 85-90% of every dollar spent on digital ad spend. And of course, the laws of supply and demand dictate that as there's more competition for a limited amount of ad inventory, that the price is going to rise. And we have seen the cost per click rise steadily over time, as reported by eMarketer, WordStream, and a few other credible sources. So my question to you is, as a smaller business, are you feeling that pressure? Is paid advertising becoming less viable for you? And if that does happen sometime in the future where the smaller players get, you know, priced out, do you think that, you know, something new and different will crop up, or, you know, will everything be, you know, brought to you by Pepsi?
I sure hope not. Well, that's a good soft drink. yes, is the short answer. You know, it's interesting because so we have a wedding stationery company that's like a division alongside Blue Eyed Sun, and it's called Ivy Ellen. That's IVYELLEN. And so that's Blue Eyed Sun, our card business, sells direct to retailers, but Ivy Ellen sells direct to consumers. So that's brides and grooms looking to get wedding stationery and invitations and all the rest of it for their weddings. And we have really beautiful products. We've done a really nice job with the company over the years. And we have had to stay on our game constantly with Google, because the website is the main driver for the sales on that business. We need to get high up on the listings when on the organic search, and we've had to pay close attention over the last 8 years that company has been running to stay on top of all these changes that, of course, Google doesn't keep the goalposts in the same place. They keep moving them. And then, so this last year, we've had a big hit from shift on the last algorithm, which essentially is favoring brands. So we were aware of this and started moving, and we had been spending an awful lot of money with SEO experts. And then we decided to not do that anymore, because we didn't seem to be getting anywhere with them. But we understood the principles of, you know, positioning the brand as a strong player within our wedding stationery market. So unfortunately, the larger websites, the obvious ones are like Etsy and Not on the High Street. Here in the UK, we have an equivalent to Etsy. It's called Not on the High Street. In fact, they're slightly stronger in the UK than Etsy. And then we also have like department stores. So we've got a department store like House of Fraser, Debenhams. We've got a card shop called Paperchase over here, which I think has some branches in the States. And these brands are now, you know, they're all on the top page of Google. So you've only got like, what is it, like 10 or 12 spots on the first page. And, you know, we just cannot compete with those guys. They've got much bigger budgets than us. They've got actually people who are in roles specifically on this one area. And we have to think creatively and think outside the box. So we do a lot of stuff with Sage. We've been a Sage customer for years. I'm a Sage business expert. As you know, I speak at their conferences. And so I'm actually going to go over and see the SEO guys at Sage to get some support and advice from them moving forward. But I think one of the things we've started to have to think about is just behaving in a more kind of guerrilla style of marketing, which is actually my favorite kind anyway. So really thinking outside the box rather than steering people to our website. Starting to post invitations, actual products directly into Instagram and into these other social sites. So you can literally just buy it from there and we'll figure out the details later once you DM us. So much more like we're starting up again. We have referral schemes. We've just done a new video for our wedding stationery company, which is part of, well, two or three variants. So one of them is like, hi, you've just met us. This is what we're about, where we're from. This is what we're going to do for you as a company. And this is why you should buy from us. And then for people that have already ordered, this is just like, thanks for your order. The second video is like, thanks for your order. This is some more about us. These are the things you can expect from us while you're getting the order and while it's being delivered for you. If you've got any problems, these are the ways to deal with it and we'll take care of it. We'll give you a 100% money back guarantee if you're not happy. So we've kind of done that money back guarantee since we start. We just didn't shout about it as much as perhaps we should have done. So, and then we've gone back to all of our old customers. The thing about weddings, unfortunately, is that once you've had them for their wedding, generally speaking, they don't come back. And you can, of course, sell them baby cards and things like that. But generally, we rely heavily on referrals. So we send all our brides and grooms a Christmas card every year to say, hi, hope you're getting on all right. Hope you had a lovely year and all the best for next year. And then we usually follow that up a couple of weeks later with an email just saying, here's a discount coupon for your friends and family, anyone that you know that's getting married this year. And that seems to have a pretty good uptake. But it is hard to compete when you're facing consumers. It's very hard to compete with these big boys. And I think new techniques will come along. We use old-fashioned techniques as well. So we still use direct mailing. Our Blue-Eyed Sun, our greeting card company, doesn't rely on pay-per-click so much. It doesn't rely on organic SEO. What I focused on with that company is creating a really great blog that's really useful for the customers that we sell to, in other words, retailers, and also helping as many people within our industry as I can. We get a lot of new startups, greeting card publishers, and you know, it's lovely to try and support creativity. So any new people that come in the industry, we do a seminar where we speak at it once a year called the Ladder Club, and we don't organize it, but I speak at it, and we invite new publishers to come along, and we tell them all the pitfalls that they should look out for, just so that they've got a bit of a head start, because it's terrible to see someone put their life savings into a business and, you know, a year or two later they're gone and you don't see them anymore. So we do a mixture of things like that, and we still use direct mail. I direct mail my customers four times a year with brochures. I email them every month, and I send them useful. So our email is not all about sales. Our email is full of things like, so for example, I'm sending one on Friday. We got a trade show in the UK next week called the called Progressive Greetings Live, or PG Live. And it's a two-day show, which is greeting card specific. I'll send out an email on Thursday to all my customers saying, we're at the show, do come and see us. And then it'll have a load of other things in it. Like, for example, if you do come to the show, here's five great restaurants nearby that you might like to try. Here's five tips for retailers that we learned doing the greeting card project on YouTube. Here's some social media tips for how to grow your retail sales using social media, even in a small town. And I think those type of ways of, you know, so basically when people open our emails, they're kind of looking forward to it and they see it as useful rather than us trying to just sell to them. And it's similar actually with the wedding business when I think about it, because we also, with all of our brides and grooms, when they contact us about their wedding stationery, we've got a huge network of other wedding vendors that we work with, both here and abroad. So, for example, DJs, photographers, venues, what have you. And invariably, there's something that our customers get stuck with, like, oh, I can't find a DJ in London this weekend. Can you recommend someone? Because of our network on Twitter and also on our database, we can help our customers with that kind of thing. I think if you're adding value in those kind of ways on top of what your product does, so your product obviously has to serve your customers well and add value, then, you know, these are the ways to fight back against these large corporations, because, you know, they can't do that kind of thing. Generally speaking, they can't. Some very good ones do, but some, you know, it's going to be tough to beat those guys.
Absolutely. Guerrilla marketing is a must, and being agile and swift and creative, because the thing about being small is that you're nimble.
Exactly.
And you can turn on a dime if necessary. So on the other side of things, talk to me a little bit about your feelings on programmatic buying and brand safety, because one of the things that larger corporations are able to do that maybe smaller businesses like us can't is that they can buy what's called programmatically, where an algorithm actually decides where your ads are shown. But there have been some rather spectacular faux pas with that, because you've had, you know, family friendly brands like Disney show ads on, you know, a KKK site or something that's just, you know, something that they don't want to be associated with. And of course, There are some back and forth between Google and Facebook, because, you know, those two properties in specific, they have made billions and billions of dollars off of other people's content. Like they're not the ones making the content, the users are. However, when you have, you know, an issue like this, they're kind of saying, oh, you know, we're tweaking our algorithm best as we can. And then you have brands pushing back like, no, we spend a lot of money with you guys, and you're putting my ad next to somewhere it doesn't belong. So speaking about brand safety, like do you think that, you know, Facebook and Google need to do a better job and not, you know, blame the algorithm? Or do you think that, you know, irrespective of technology, that brand safety is ultimately the responsibility of the business owner?
I do think that these, you know, these companies like YouTube and Google have a responsibility to look out for. And of course, you know, it's all moving so fast, they can't keep on top of it always. But, you know, they're not alone with this issue. Of course, we've seen this in newspapers, haven't you? I'm trying to wrap my brains to think of an example, but I've seen it in newspapers sometimes where you've got, you know, you've got one terrible, tragic news story, and then underneath there's an ad for something that's kind of related, but completely in an inappropriate way. So, you know, we have seen these things before. I think certainly, you know, the sort of remarketing ads that show up around the internet, and particularly on, you know, sites that are promoting violence or just nasty things in the world, you know, definitely we don't want that. I mean, certainly we wouldn't want any of our, you know, remarketed content to appear on, you know, in any kind of pornographic sites or any KKK sites or anything like that. And I think it's, I think brands are going to start holding these guys more accountable, much in the same way, you know, it sounds like it's quite similar, isn't it, to the sort of fake news. You know, it's down to us as consumers to complain about these things to brands. I think brands do need to take a responsibility. They can't just point the finger. They have to say, yep, you know, we have some part in this. And you know, and actually I think we're going to see probably more of a crossover between people like, you know, I love, do you watch that TV series The Good Wife?
I do not, but I know about it.
But yeah, so there's a character in that called Eli Gold, and he's kind of like the spin doctor for the politician character, for the senator. And you know, and he's really good at fielding situations, like how to react to things properly. And it was funny because they had one incident, I think, I can't remember the details of it, but it was something along the lines of some CEO of some company at the food in the canteen at the school had made all the children sick. So he had these awful images on the news of children throwing up everywhere on the back of, and Eli Gold had tried to get hold of him and say, whatever you do, don't say that you want to know whether kitchens are kept clean. And, cause you know, trying to point the blame somewhere else. And, And of course, he went and said the wrong thing. And it reminded me a lot of when the United Airlines incident happened a couple of months back with the passenger getting dragged off the plane. You know, the CEO of that company did pretty much the same thing, where it's like, you know, we stand by our employees, which on the one hand seems really, you know, like the right thing to do. But of course, he just was completely disassociated from the sentiment of the public out there. And so we again, in the same way, you know, we need these voices of reason in amongst us, in the same way that we need them on committees that are producing content with influencers. You know, earlier with the Kendall Jenner thing that we were talking about, you know, we need voices of reason. We need benchmarks to check. Now, it should be that we all have these voices of reason. I think the trouble is people end up in corporations, or they end up in situations and groups where perhaps they don't feel like they have the political power within there to actually stand up and say no to something, or maybe just, you know, they're like frogs in hot water, where they haven't noticed that their environment has completely changed around them, and the way that they respond to that has completely changed. So, you know, I think going forward, we need these voices of reason to keep us on top of these things.
Frogs in hot water. I love that analogy, and it's so pertinent. So last question, and I'll let you get back to your day. And I do appreciate you taking the time, but I am going to take just a few minutes to set it up, because I want you to understand why I'm asking it the way that I'm asking it. And so it's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast, but I'm staring at it in a very particular direction, because in my personal and professional opinion, there's a gap in the professional digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean someone who works in-house at a brand or agency. I am not referring to digital entrepreneurship, solopreneurs, somebody like a Pat Flynn or John Lee Dumas, even though you can absolutely make the case that they're pros because they operate at such a high level. It's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, people who get a W-2 or 1099 at the end of the year. And in terms of professionalizing yourself, there's sort of three main tracks in digital marketing. The first is to just Google it, which you can find a lot of good information out there, most of which is for free. However, contrary to popular belief, rooting it out does take a degree of skill on the part of the searcher. You might land on convince and convert. You might end up doing Amway. Like who knows where that Google rabbit hole goes? You can do what I did, which was go back to school and get a degree in internet marketing. The cons there is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000, and it's time consuming, because even though my degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. And in the digital landscape, 30 months is several lifetimes. Like, a lot can change in the space of 30 months. But by far, the most prevalent way that people educate themselves and disseminate best in class practices is through conferences and seminars. The problem there is that even though in aggregate, it's a lot less expensive than a degree program, you got to have the money up front. So take some of your better digital marketing conferences like a South by Southwest or a Social Media Marketing World. You're looking at between $500 and $1,500 just to get through the door. That does not include your flight, your hotel, Uber back and forth, food for however many days. So after you factor all of that stuff back in, you're easily looking at between $3,000 and $5,000 on a single conference. And some of them, like ClickFunnels, have a, you know, VIP coaching, inner circle program, whatever you want to call it, and that can be upwards of $10,000. So even though in aggregate, you know, $10,000-$15,000 is a lot less than the $60,000 you're going to have to pay it full sale, you got to have the money up front. Like they don't have a financial aid program. So what I'm trying to do is crowdsource, if you will, a way of professionalizing yourself that does not include rolling a dice on Google, having to sell your firstborn to the Department of Education, or having to mortgage your house so you can afford to go to a conference. So now that I've done rambling for however long, I'll ask the actual question, which is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skill, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right. You are college freshman broke, Jeremy. You have somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you Build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free.
Nice. I like that question. That's a challenging one. Well, I'm a people person, Tammy. So I would do some on the laptop. For me, the most exciting space for me right now is WhatsApp. So I have a variety of groups that I'm involved with on WhatsApp, and they are live real time. I compare them to like a pub. And in fact, when you were asking that question, I was thinking, well, what city am I in? If I'm in New York, I'd choose the right pub, and I'd get down there and start chatting with people, because you just need to broaden your network as quickly as you can. Of course, social media tools are absolutely fantastic for that these days. And so you can kind of build these networks really quickly. I like the randomness of networks though. So I was talking earlier about open, random, and supportive. If you are just selective and controlling with these things, people kind of smell that out. So you might make a list of people Ryan Fanzo and Gary V and all the rest of them, and say, right, I'm going to go to South by Southwest this year and target specifically these guys. But, they get people like that coming at them all the time. So, I think actually, and unless you've got something to offer them, and sometimes I think something to offer them can be as simple as a good time and lots of laughter. But at the same time, I don't think you can be massively strategic in the face of this, because what is it? A friend of mine. So last year at Sage Summit, I was in Chicago speaking in the Chicago Sage Summit a year ago. And I met a lovely guy called Justin Packshaw, who's become a friend of mine. He's an explorer, and he's done the North Pole, the South Pole. He's climbed Everest. And he's an amazing guy and very inspirational. And he said to me in that Uber ride, we were chatting about this kind of thing, and he said, well, you got to remember, Jeremy, desperate ain't sexy. And so, the first thing I'd say is don't be desperate, stay relaxed, build the network, don't be too desperate about it, and offer good value. So if I've got the knowledge that I have now, I've got no money, I've just got a laptop, I'd start joining some of these groups and I'd start helping people. I'd be open. I'd open to all comers. I'd be random in terms of the people that I helped, and I'd be supportive. Through time, what comes of that is, it's a different type of marketing. I have a blog post called Marketing Then Versus Now. It's at bluehedsun.co.uk/blog. And in that post, I talk about two characters at a party. There's Hank and there's Bob. And so Hank is the kind of guy that corners you in the room and he's trying to sell you insurance at the party, and you just wish you'd be anywhere but next to him. And as soon as someone comes over to join you, you get out of there as quickly as possible and leave them with him. But Bob, on the other hand, Bob's at the party and he, you might get chatting with Bob and he says, well, you mentioned that you got a painful lower back. And he said, oh, you should see my friend Anne. She's a great chiropractor. Let me give you her number. And you get her number and off you go, and Anne takes care of you. And you're seeing Anne. She says, oh, how did you come here? And you say, oh, Bob at the party sent me over. And she says, oh, Bob, he's fantastic. Such a great guy. He's really supportive. He helped me and my family when we were first moving into town. He's got the lovely hardware store. You should go check it out. And so actually through just going well in the world and being supportive and helpful, eventually that goodwill will come back to you. And I see this in my WhatsApp groups. So the WhatsApp groups are like a live they're like a live pub. They're not like a Twitter feed or a Facebook where you want to scroll back up and try and read every messages. I mean, some of my WhatsApp group messages go up to 500 plus messages a day. I don't get a chance to read all of them. I don't bother. I basically look at it as like, right, I've got 20 minutes. I'm on the train or whatever. I'm going to pop into the pub and see what people are up to and what they're talking about. And so the particular pubs or groups that I'm involved with, they're very interesting. They have a real diverse range of people. And often if you're showing a bit of vulnerability, I don't know if I'm sure you and your listeners have probably seen the Brené Brown talk on vulnerability on TED.com. But I think vulnerability is, she says in it that it's the last thing that I'm prepared to show you and the first thing I'm looking for in you. And so if you're in those groups and you're being supportive and then you're also being human, in other words, you're showing your vulnerability and you're asking questions like, I need a bit of help on this particular subject. Does anyone know anything about this? Then people step up and they help, just as you would if someone was asking a similar question in a knowledge base that you're knowledgeable on. So that's kind of how I would do it. I would also have a sense of what I wanted to do. So you know, I'd be paying attention to what's going on. I happen to love marketing, so it would probably be something in marketing, but I would choose a niche to focus on rather than, you know, trying to be all things to all people. Certainly in the groups, if you've got knowledge that helps people, then you can do that. But a friend of mine's a business consultant. He was generally a small business kind of guru about 5 years ago, and then he chose to specialize in digital agencies. His name's Robert Craven. He's a British business expert. And, you know, it's been fantastic watching his business grow of late, and he's doing a lot of work with Google and these kind of guys because, you know, I guess he recognized that digital agencies were going to be a fast-growing sector of the market, and he enjoyed working with those companies and wanted to sort of focus on that. So I think having a niche or as you say, niche over there in the States, you know, to focus on, I think is good. And then, you know, putting yourself out and about and being supportive and open, random, supportive is how I do it.
Open, random, and supportive, and pop into the pub on WhatsApp. I think that's the first WhatsApp answer I've gotten. So that's really cool. Jeremy, this has been tremendous. Thank you so much. Please take a moment. Tell us about your YouTube channel. Give us all your social media handles. Tell us a little bit more about Blue Eyed Sun. Where can we get some more of you?
Okay. Well, my YouTube channel is youtube.com/thegreetingcardproject. So do check it out, and please leave comments if you like the videos. If you don't like them, tell me what you don't like about them. I'd love to hear anyone's feedback. I'm constantly evolving this project, seeing where it takes me. It's a real journey, personal journey. So I'd love to share it with your listeners, and please do watch those videos if you can. My blog is blueeyedsun.co.uk/blog. Again, I do talk about things that I've learned doing the YouTube channel. So if you want to keep up to date with someone who's kind of exploring, testing this kind of thing and seeing what's working and what's not working and the personal challenges I've come up against doing it, then do check that out. It's also great if you're a retailer. I've got lots of tips and advice for retailers on my blog, plus some images and some information on beautiful greeting cards if you like that kind of thing as well. And my wedding business is ivyellen.com, ivyellen.com. So if you're getting married or you know someone's getting married, please do send them my way. If they put my name, Jeremy, J-E-R-E-M-Y, into the coupon code box, they can get 10% off. And my personal Twitter handle is at Jeremy Corner. That's J-E-R-E-M-Y-C-O-R-N-E-R. And it's the same at Facebook, LinkedIn, and Instagram, which I've just started using this year and having a lot of fun on there, getting huge engagement there. So, yeah, if you're on any of those platforms, I'd love to connect with you.
And there you have it, folks. Go check it out. As you've just seen, the man knows his stuff and is a fountain of information. So, Jeremy, cheers. This has been tremendous.
Thanks, Timmy. I've had a great time.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.